Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Thank you, Beasley. And here we are for the 100th episode of Fireside Chat. As always, I'm Dan, and for 100 episodes now, I'm joined by my co-host, Matt. How you doing, buddy?
Good. It's actually my 100th episode. You did miss one.
Oh, right.
In the first season, you did. So
that's right.
You're still on 99.
There you go. Next week, I'll be on 100. Can you believe that we're at 100 episodes already? This is our fourth season, our fourth hockey season doing this, and we thought we were doing good, and we made it to 25 episodes.
Well, time flies when you're having fun, and it's been a blast covering the Flames over the last 4 years. It's neat to see the team go from like the end of the previous era and start the whole rebuilding process and getting to watch all the new faces actually grow within the organization.
For sure. Yeah, I think, you know, if there's a time in the Flames period when it made sense to do this show, it's now. I mean, you know, you wouldn't have been doing a podcast back in 89. Nobody knew what the internet was. But, you know, even during the end of the Young Guns era, it wouldn't have made sense. But, yeah, we came on the air right, I think, within weeks of the last lockout finishing. And we've really been going strong since then. So we've seen the end of sort of the last era of the Flames. We've seen the end of the Jerome McGinley era. We've seen this new era get ushered in. And I think it's pretty cool.
Yeah, and we're looking forward to the next 100 episodes and hopefully a Stanley Cup sometime in the near future.
Hopefully within the next 100 episodes.
Yeah.
So as a blast from the past, our first episode was January 19th, 2013. And here we are sitting talking together on December 7th, 2015. So a couple years we've been doing this. If anyone wants to go back and listen to the episode, you do have it in the archives. It's on our website at firesidechat.ca. I actually went back and listened to the episode this year, and we've really come a long way, my friend.
Yeah. Well, especially because neither one of us really had any media training coming into starting this whole venture. So now we're a little bit more polished, and it's a lot easier now than when we started. We were just trying to figure out how to make things work properly.
Well, I've been thinking this week and reflecting on the show. There's some people that I don't want to spend too much time on this because people are here for Flames news, but there's some people I want to thank, some people I want to acknowledge for where we are today. I think it's fair to acknowledge our original co-host. This was originally a three-man show. For those that heard us in the first season, we had myself, Matt, and another gentleman, Luke Wellner-Monchuk, who joined us. And we've changed the format to a two-man show, but Luke was instrumental in helping conceive Fireside Chat. He came up with the name Fireside Chat. So we owe a lot to Luke from the first couple seasons. I think I also want to thank Beasley, the overhead voice of the Flames. Beasley's been instrumental in helping us. He, as you guys know and heard earlier, he did our intro. Beasley's an old radio guy, and he's always been there for advice and help when we need it. I want to thank the behind-the-scenes talent that you guys often don't hear from. Mike Crosby has been on the show a few times. Brett Bauer, they were our former editors and producers. And now we have a gentleman named Peter Marino is helping us. All of them are from the SATE radio program. So they don't get enough credit sometimes, but they're the ones that make us sound great every week. And last but not least, I want to thank the Calgary Flames. We've been starting a relationship with them over the last couple years. Any of you that have been listening for a while know that we've been going down to the training camps in the summer, talking to some of the rookies, and we're hoping that we can make that relationship a lot more in-depth as we go forward. Matt, anyone you want to thank quickly?
I'd want to thank all the listeners for making this possible, because we wouldn't be doing this if you people weren't listening. And that getting the feedback from the fans after every season on all the things that we have to work on to make things better, it's always appreciated. Anytime you have any feedback, it's always appreciated. And we're just thankful for you people listening.
Without everyone listening, we wouldn't be doing this. We'd be sitting in our basement talking to each other.
Exactly.
All right, Matt. Well, with that done, why don't we jump into some Flames news?
Sounds like a plan.
two games this past week. We'll look at them both. Both of them at home. We came back off of a road swing, and both of them wins. Something that neither you nor I were predicting for this week. Looking at the two games, let's start at the beginning of the week at the Dallas Stars game. You and I were both in attendance. I was actually there with my mom. I took her to her first ever Calgary Flames game, and she just loved it. It was a great night for her. She enjoyed everything about it. But we're sitting there in the stands watching, and you know, by the end of the second, the Flames are down 3-0, and I'm like, oh crap! I brought my mom to another slaughter for the Flames, but. Wow, this had to be, I think, one of the most interesting Flames games, probably the most interesting Flames game this year, if not the most interesting Flames game I can remember. We were down by 3, and we came back to win it 4-3. What were your thoughts on the game, Matt?
At the beginning of the game, it was a tale of two teams that were clearly in opposite sides of the standings, and you could see that Dallas was pretty much just having their way with Calgary. Pretty much for the first 30 minutes of the contest, and Calgary didn't have anything going their way until about the halfway point, and then they started to turn it around. I think Monahan had 3 posts in the second period alone, and yeah, the Flames managed to finally break through on Backlund's 4th shot in like 5 seconds. And then another one, and Dougie Hamilton scoring late to force it to overtime, and then the eventual shootout winner.
Yeah, I was watching that. I agree with you at the beginning. It looked like Dallas was having their way with us, and it really wasn't until about the midway point in the second, we started to see the Flames come to life and really taking a command of the game, not just playing well, but they were really dictating the pace. They were really dictating how the game was being played. And we saw in the second they didn't get any goals, but they were really coming hard at the Dallas net. Dallas has got 2 good goaltenders, so they played Niemi, who's a good goalie in his own right. He was saving everything. But I remember turning to my mom at the end of the second and saying, you know what, if they keep playing like this, they could win this game.
Yeah, and that's the team that we remember from last year. Even though something screwed up in the first half of the game and you fell down 3-0, there was always the belief in the team that, okay, yeah, we're down 3, who cares? You know, we can just go out and score 3 and we'll tie it. Who cares?
What's 3 goals?
Yeah, big deal. Who cares? And we haven't seen that at all at any point this season, really. And now that they got one under their belt, hopefully that spurs them on moving forward.
Couple notes I had on this game. I thought Michael Backlund played really well. He was very aggressive. He was getting himself in every play. When I watched Backlund, I thought, wow, if Michael can play like that every game, this guy could be a legitimate top 6, and people might stop talking about trading this kid.
Yeah, and that's the problem with Backlund, is that he offensively he is somewhat inconsistent. On the defensive side, he's always pretty good, and rarely does he make any glaring mistakes, but when it comes to actually putting the puck in the net, he does tend to disappear for like 10 or 15 games, then go on a little hot streak, and then right back to being cold again. If he can get that offensive consistency, that would definitely help the team moving forward.
I also thought that Jones, as we've seen, I don't know if it's just because it's a contract year, what's gotten into him, but he was doing really well in front of the net. He did some great work. He was getting some shots in. He was always digging, trying to get the puck past the goalies. I haven't been to many Flames games live this year, but it was nice to see for the first time, I guess, you know, live at the Dome, the different David Jones that we're seeing this year.
You could tell that he's motivated to have another contract after this year. With how other players have struggled getting contracts other than like tryouts in preseason, he wants to make sure that when July 1st comes, he is going to have his name on a contract. And the only way to do that is to play well. And he has been doing that.
Yeah, I think that Glenn Cross situation may have spooked him or his agent or both of them a little bit to say, like, hey, you got to prove your worth here.
Exactly. And it's something that I think all players should be trying to do and focusing on.
And hopefully not just in their contract year.
No, but especially in a contract year, they need to make sure that they're playing at a level where somebody will want you to come in and play. Because especially with other teams and like how good scouting has been around the NHL, teams are finding more and more talent, and you can start plugging in guys on a, you know, league minimum contracts instead of signing this okay third, fourth line guy. And that's what I think is changing of late, is that a lot of teams have that depth where before it was some teams did, some teams didn't. Like, if you look at Calgary, like, we could recall Bill Arnold, Kenny Agostino, Poirier, Drew Shore, Derek Grant, Freddie Hamilton, and, like, they could all slot in and play well at the NHL level.
We got a handful of guys.
So that competition there wasn't there previous, but now, like, a lot of teams have that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and maybe not as much depth as we do, but enough depth that, you know, if you lose one or two guys to UFA, you can either replace them internally or you'll pick up somebody's third line guy off, July 1st as a UFA and pay them less than $1 million.
True. Or you can get a better player, like how the Flames got Frolik, and slot him into an even higher spot on the roster and not have to worry about the depth as much.
Yeah, we're seeing a lot less of the franchise players. We're seeing more guys who are moving through their career and moving more often. So I think that, you know, you definitely, yeah, if you want to stay with the same team, not just in your contract year, but I think we're going to see guys who have to be producing more consistently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, usually the only players that stick with the team for a long time are your bona fide first line talents like Monahan, Gaudreau, Bennett. Like, you look at Anaheim, like, they have Perry and Getzlaff, who have been there since, like, 2005. So, and you can go team by team of players that, like, Patrick Marleau's been there since 97. So, those guys tend to stick, but, like, everybody else does, it's, everybody else is movable.
A couple other notes I had from this game. I thought, especially in the second and third period, the Flames did very well of controlling the puck in the offensive zone. In the first period, we saw what we've seen from the Flames a lot, where they let that puck come out at the blue line, and then they're chasing it all the way back to their own end and wasting time and tiring themselves out. And in that second and third period especially, we really saw the Flames keeping the puck in and moving it from the blue line up towards the net, and I think that's part of why they had so much success.
Well, that was the hallmark of the Flames last year, was that they would be in on the guys. If they dumped it in, they were there. If they brought it in, they had multiple options to pass to and generate offense. This year, it's been like they'll dump it in, and a couple of guys will half-heartedly skate to it, and the other team will recover, and it's out the other end. So it's encouraging to see them modify their game so that they're playing more like they did last year.
Yeah, and I think we have to give credit here to Kerry Ramo, too. This might have been Ramo's best game of the year so far. He looked like the Kerry Ramo that we saw at his peak last year.
Yeah, he's been playing well recently. Even in games last week that he lost, he was still fairly effective.
And then after that game, I know everyone was getting excited. We even had some people on Twitter, at 76 Swanson, Ryan, tweeted to us right after that game, and Ryan said, I know it's one game, but was last night's game a sign of things to come for the Flames? And, you know, it's tough to know. It was tough to know after one game if that was a sign of things to come. It looked like the Flames from last year, and we could only hope. The Flames took a couple days off, and then they had the big band Bruins come in on Friday, and again won what I think was a very similar game in execution. a 5-4 win for the Flames in OT. They didn't need the shootout in this one. This was different and exciting to me because the Flames got up 2-0, which is not something we've seen from the team a lot this year.
I think that might be one of our very few two-goal leads. I think the only other time we had a two-goal lead was against Pittsburgh.
Yeah, I think you're right. And then, I mean, you know, Boston came back with two, and then we pretty much traded from there. We got one, Boston got one, Boston got another, and we got another. And it really took the overtime period, and I'm so glad that Dougie Hamilton got the assist on the overtime goal. It just seems...
Especially after that penalty shot where he was the cause of it.
Yeah.
He went from goat to hero within 5 minutes.
Well, let's talk about that. So that was interesting. In the third period, there was a shorthanded goal. It was a penalty shot. Boston was shorthanded. And Brian Marchand scored, which you don't see a lot of scored penalty shots. And I don't know about you, but after that one, it was tied at that point. What? It was tied...
It was 3-3. Right. That was the go-ahead goal.
It was 3-3. And I don't know about you, but I thought, oh, crap, we're done. Like,
actually, with the Flames still being on the power play, I thought that we were going to... We had a good chance to come back. It wasn't... I didn't think... as the play progressed, I didn't think that they were actually going to manage, but with 1.2 seconds left, Yuri Hudler pushed it over the line.
Can we round it up to two?
No.
Can we round it down to one? Or does that have to be 1.2? Is that more epic?
Makes it more accurate, I guess.
And, you know, I think one of the things not a lot of people thought about in this game was really that penalty shot almost acts as a pseudo timeout. You know, none of the Flames are on the ice except for the goalie. So I think it gave the Flames a quick minute to get a breather and go from there. But, yeah, as soon as the play was developing after that, I thought, crap, we're done. Boston, you know, they got our number in, I guess, the best way possible if you're going to lose from penalty shot. But Hudler took it to overtime, and I had a funny feeling once he was going overtime, I was sitting around saying, the Flames got this one.
Yeah, I was looking at the bench, when's Gaudreau going to hop over? And he had two goals already in the game, and I was hoping for the hat trick, and thankfully that's how it ended up happening.
Yeah. And better 3-on-3 position in this game than the Dallas game, I thought. In the Dallas game, they often didn't have a man in front. There were times that we were putting the puck in from the blue line, but our forward was not in front of the net to get the rebound or try to bang it home. And I think that's part of the reason that we couldn't settle the Dallas game in overtime with 3-on-3. And I think we're seeing better positioning from the guys in the overtime period in the Boston game.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
So as much as the Flames had two hard-earned wins, as much as the Flames looked like they were going back to their ways from last year, turns out that you take one step forward and two steps backwards. We won all of our games this year. We have an exciting week of hockey, but we fell in the standings. We're now in sole possession of, what, 30th in the league?
Yeah, unfortunately. It's been a weird season lately. You win all your games in a week. You end up dropping a couple of spots in the standings. On this date, December 7th, as we're recording this, there have been 30 teams in the league. Only one time has a team actually been within 10 points of a playoff spot. And it was the Tampa Bay Lightning, I do believe, in 2000.
So you're saying a team that was in 30th place but was within 10 points of a playoff spot.
Yeah. It was in 2008. And they were 9 points out of a playoff spot while being in 30th. The Flames, though, and that was the best example since there's been 30 teams in the league. Calgary is only 5 points out of a playoff spot. Which doesn't make a lot of sense because usually if you're down and out in 30th, like, you're irrelevant. But the Flames are only 5 points out, and that's a big hurdle to climb, but it's not 10, 12, 14, 16 points. So even though we're 30th, the season could still go either way.
It's 3 games.
Yeah, exactly. And we do play San Jose, who is 6 points ahead of the Flames currently. if the Flames win that in regulation, now they're within 4 points. So the Flames have to win a lot this month to overcome some of the deficit that they've built up. But it is possible.
Yeah, if we look at the standings in the Pacific Division, we're last with 22 points. We've got Edmonton, who's right above us at 24 points. Vancouver's only got 26. Anaheim and Arizona are tied at 27, and San Jose has 28. There's no way we're going to catch LA at 35. But, you know, even if we can get to where Arizona's at, which, I mean, Arizona's a terrible team this year. I'm surprised they're that far ahead of us. Well, I guess shouldn't be. We've been playing pretty terrible, but I think Arizona's going to bottom out pretty soon, and we might be able to swap spots with them.
Yeah, I look at the standings, and I still pencil in Anaheim as one of the two teams. So
when I look at these, I think San Jose is going to stagnate pretty quick. I don't think that they're going to maintain the pace they've been on all year. I think that Anaheim's going to take their spot. I think we're going to have LA and Anaheim as the sort of default 1-2 in Pacific. I don't think Arizona can keep up their pace. I don't think Edmonton's going to keep up their pace. So I look at it as Calgary and Winnipeg battling for that number 3 spot in the Pacific.
Vancouver, you mean?
Vancouver. Sorry. Yeah, Calgary and Vancouver, I think, are going to battle for that last spot in the Pacific Division. I think Winnipeg will battle for one of the wild card spots. But it's weird that the wild card teams have less points than two of the teams in the Pacific Division, just the way things are working out now. But, yeah, I don't know. I think, like you said, 5 points is much. It's 3 wins. And we happen to have 3 games coming up this week. It's still something that's within the realm of possibility, but we have to keep the pace up. We can't go through another week of no wins.
Yeah, getting 1 point. Like, especially the upcoming road trip after this week. We play Nashville, Dallas, St. Louis, and Detroit. And the worst of those 4 teams is 11th in the NHL. So they can't go 0-4. And in order for the Flames to get back into it, they need at least 2 of the 3 this week and probably at least .500 on the road. So it's still a long mountain to climb, but there is a chance.
What worries me is if you look historically at our 2 wins in a row. So back in November, we played against the Flyers and won, and then we played against the Penguins and won. Again, games that people were surprised we won. Then we went on a 2-game losing streak. Then we won later in the month when we were at home again. We won a game against the Devils and one against the Blackhawks. And then we went on pretty much a 3-game losing streak, one of which was in overtime, but 3 losses. Now we've got 2 more wins. We're still at home, though, which is different this time. Usually we're picking up 2 wins and then heading back on the road. So it's going to be different, but even if, say, next week we win 2 of those, we can't then go on a 3-game streak. Like, I think we got to get at least 1 a week, every week from here on in, to even have a chance.
Yeah, and realistically, the Flames do need to be at, like, a .600 winning percentage the rest of the way. It's one of those things that if they can manage to erase the deficit, then it's just a sprint of 2 teams that are at equal points in the standings running the rest of the way. The first thing, though, is that they have to erase that deficit and getting back on even keel.
I think the fact that we have 3 more home games, though, is really going to help with that.
Yeah.
Because we've been playing a lot better at the Dome than we have on the road historically.
Yeah, I think they're on a 6-game home winning streak at the moment, so if they can keep that going, even if they do drop 1 of the 3, they need at least 2 more wins this week.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think if the Flames play the way that they have been the last 2 games, and, I mean, I don't know about you, I think they looked like last year's team in those 2 games.
Yeah, and they're playing a lot more like the team that we're used to, and like we're seeing increased performances from guys like Mark Giordano, who has struggled for most of the year. Dougie Hamilton is playing like he did in Boston. So,
and if they can keep doing that, I think they've got a shot at erasing some of that deficit.
Exactly. And they just have to keep winning, period. End of story, they have to walk away with 2 points. And any way they can do that, they have to do it.
We've been saying that every week, and it's been sort of hard to believe it, but I think after seeing the last two games, I'm a little bit more confident that, okay, maybe this team can actually start to win, you know? Like, before we're getting a win, and then we get a couple of losses, and they'd be like, okay, capture that magic in a bottle. But two big wins that they've had in a row, it's like, okay, maybe these guys are finally starting to figure things out.
It would be interesting if you compare this season to last year. The Flames had a pretty good October, a very good November, and then went on an 8-game losing streak in December. If now this year the Flames were kind of terrible in October, middling in November, and if they can go on a tear, they might actually be at the same point as they were last year heading into January. But we have to see, and hopefully the Flames can get like a 6 or 7 or 8 game winning streak going and get the ball rolling.
Well, let's hope that we can keep this going into next week. You know, we could sit here and speculate all night on what's going to happen, but I think it's just a matter of, can we roll this momentum into next week? And that's going to be the big thing. And then after that, can we roll it onto the road trip? And I think we got to take this sort of a game at a time right now.
Yeah, and if they can build on it, like, if they have a successful homestand, then the next challenge is, okay, we've been terrible on the road. We have to change that and get success on the road. Cause especially in January, I think the Flames only play 5 games in the Saddle Dome. So they're going to need to learn how to win on the road if they actually do manage to have a successful December.
Yeah, you're definitely right, and it's going to be, I mean, we've got, you know, the Sharks coming in next. We'll talk about the upcoming games later in the show, but we got the Sharks next, we got Buffalo, we have New York. I think that, you know, you've got a mix of good and not so good in that group, and if you can beat them, and if we could put together, you know, 5-game win streak or 4 or 5 at home, it shows these guys you can win. It's not a fluke. You can do this, you know, like, even if we can win one of next week, having 3 of the 5, still is, you know, better than half. You can do this, guys. It shouldn't matter if we're here or there. Just keep doing whatever it is you're doing.
Mm-hmm. Building on the little successes as in each game. And, like, if you look at the Dallas game through the Boston game, once the Flames started doing the little things correctly, they tore the other team apart, really, and ended up getting 4 points out of it. It was all the little details that allowed the rest of the team to have success. And it was the lack of attention to the little details that has caused the Flames to have so much trouble in the early going.
And that's what we've talked about in the past of playing a complete 60-minute game. So I think we need to see how they're going to respond after these two. If they're going to do what we've seen historically, like I said earlier, and lose 2 or 3 in a row, or if they can keep this going. And only time will tell. Matt, we had some unfortunate injuries this week. David Jones went out of the Boston game with a lower body injury after he blocked that shot with his foot. That looked nasty to me, and it sounds like he's back, unless you've heard anything different. It sounds like he'll be playing this week, but I was really worried after seeing him block that shot with his foot. I thought it could be a long-term injury.
Yeah, I was thinking it might be something like a broken foot, but he was at practice today. Whether he plays tomorrow, it's still likely a game-time decision, but at least he's practicing. That's the positive thing.
In any other season, I wouldn't be too worried if we lost David Jones to a foot injury for a bit, but he's a guy who looks like he deserves to be on the top line this year, and you don't want to lose any of your top producers, so I'm glad that he'll probably be back this week. The other guy that was injured this week who missed the Bruins game was Chris Russell. He missed the Bruins game. He was not at practice today, right?
Yeah, and it's doubtful that he will be back for the Sharks
San Jose game.
Yeah, so We'll see. I don't know if he'll even be ready for either the Sabres or the Rangers game later in the week
He's a
either,
guy
so.
that I want to make sure we rest if we need to rest him. Not just because we need him on the ice, but we also need him to be ready as a trade asset later, and it's tough to move him if he's hurt. So I think, you know, with especially with the defenseman and having the ability to call a guy like Nakladol up or Kulak up, you know, if he needs to get a game or two extra, I wouldn't rush him back in there.
No, and with Vladdy Smead playing effectively in the Dallas game and then in the Boston game, you can have the third pairing being Englund Smead and not worry too much. And you can rely on the top four guys covering most of the night without much worry.
Yeah. And if, you know, if Smead Englund isn't working out for you, you've got some options to bring up from the farm. But I don't want to rush Russell back. I think that if we've seen him kind of, you know, a few times this season get a little banged up and maybe just needs to sit out for a couple. And probably better do that at home than try to sit him on the road and still go through the rigors of the road.
I agree.
Another good, I guess a good piece of Flames news from the injury front is Lance Bouma rejoined the team for practice over the weekend. He was on the ice on Sunday with his team, which means that he's inching closer to being in the lineup. He didn't have the...
Yeah, he's ahead of schedule.
Yeah, and he didn't have the, what is it now, blue or yellow? They change it every once in a while. The no-contact jersey on.
Yeah, he returned to full practice. He won't be in the lineup this week. He will probably get his first game sometime middle of next week on the road. It's more just for conditioning purposes, getting back up to full tempo.
Yeah, from what I understand, he was on the ice. He was doing everything in a full practice. He said to the media after practice that he's not putting a timeline on his return. It's whenever he thinks he's ready and the doctors think he's ready, so he doesn't want to tell us that. But from what I've been hearing, they expect him to go on the road with the team next week. So the worst projection I've heard is that he'll be back in the Winnipeg game before Christmas. But I like you, I'm expecting he'll probably be back for either Dallas or St. Louis next week. And it'd be good to get him back in. I think that Boma's energy has been missing from this team. It'll be interesting to see where they slot him in when he comes back and if he can pick up the great season he had from last year. But I don't know about you, but I've really felt Boma's energy missing from the lineup.
And our penalty kill has suffered from his absence of being able to block shots with regularity. And it one of the things last season early in the year, he was blocking shots with such regularity that it seemed to spark the rest of the team, and not having him in the lineup doing that, I think, has partially contributed to the Flames' struggles because they haven't been able to get that momentum builder that they had all through, like, November and December last year.
Well, not only that, but I think if you look, he had 104 shots last year. He had 16 goals and 18 assists for 34 points. Like, 16 goals is a lot of goals, especially for a guy who, you know, is sort of that fourth-line energy player. So hopefully we can see him get back on that pace, even though there's no way he'll be playing 78 games this year. But hopefully we can get him back on that pace and get some offensive production out of him, too, that we've been lacking.
Even if he's just directing pucks at net, that's a huge improvement from a lot of the guys that have been playing on the third and fourth line thus far this season.
Yeah, I think that they've been trying to give a lot of that energy role to Bolig, and I don't know about you, but I'm expecting once Bouma comes back, we're going to see a lot less of Bolig in the lineup.
I could see that. It'll be one of, like, Raymond Juris and Bouma that'll get sat each game. If the other team doesn't have a lot of physicality to them, I think you'll see either Juris or Raymond draw in. And if they do, then both Bouma and Bouma will be on the lineup.
While we're on the topic of guys drawing in, I'm happy to see that Granlund's still around. I think that he's been earning his keep over the last week. I'm hoping, as we've talked about in the past, he'll stay here, but he looked good to me in the Dallas game. He wasn't as offensively in there as I hoped he would be, but he's played five games this year and has one goal already and seven shots. So to me, he's looking good. He's looking like he deserves to stay here. So I'm glad they're giving him that option.
Yeah, and he hasn't looked out of place being in the top six. And
he looks comfortable with his line mates, too.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that he was lacking at times last year, was not necessarily being comfortable in each situation. Like when he was with Gaudreau and Hudler briefly, he did. And when he was with Berchi at one point, he did. But by and large, he was kind of inconsistent when he was with anybody else. And hopefully he can continue to play effectively and perhaps generate some offense to make sure that he maintains his spot in the lineup.
Yeah, I think last year, if you look at it, we've called it inconsistency, but I think if you look back at it, he was comfortable with a certain set of guys, but he didn't rise to the occasion often. The team would try to give him a second-line role or a first-line role, and he would look like he was playing above his level. So I'm glad to see they've given him a top-six shot. I think that's where he will eventually perhaps end up on the team as a second-, third-line guy. And as long as he keeps, you know, handling that and playing well in that role, I'm hoping they're going to keep him on the team.
And realistically, if you look at the other guys that he's competing with, would you keep him in the lineup, or would you bring Juris back? Or would you keep Raymond in over him? Like, to me...
Well, I think, too, with the fact that we're going to see... I think it's a given we're going to see some movement at forward this year. You have to kind of keep him up here to keep him... you know, primed and ready to go for when eventually one
True.
Of those forwards
And
move.
You also have to evaluate for next year as well. So if he doesn't rise to the occasion, then you can kind of pencil him in as a maybe player next year, not a definite guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he's probably the one guy, as we've talked about, who can't be at the AHL level anymore. Like, there's just nothing left there for him. So it's either, okay, you bring him up to the NHL and you play him, or... I guess move him. Like, I just don't think that there's much point in sending him back to the A at this stage.
No, and he's pretty much graduated. So if he doesn't stick, then he's like a quadruple A player, if you're a baseball fan. Somebody who's too good for the minors, but not good enough to stick in the majors. And
we call it the 13th forward in the NHL.
True.
There's no quadruple A in baseball, is
no,
there?
No, it's triple A, but somebody that's too good for that league, but not good enough for the majors.
So, yeah, no, I think Granlund has NHL chops, and I'm glad that they're playing him and letting him see what he's got this year and trying him in some different situations. Matt, it's mid-December, which also means it's almost time for the World Juniors. You usually watch the World Juniors, don't you?
Yeah, for sure. Especially when, with looking ahead to the draft, I'm always keying on, like, who are the draft-eligible guys for each team. So that way, when I do my prospect profiles, I have some frame of reference.
Yeah. And this year's World Juniors are close to home, which is nice. They'll be December 26th. They always start on Boxing Day through the 5th. And it's going to be co-hosted by Toronto and Montreal. So nice and close. I know that the Flames had a tickets deal recently, and I was looking at it, and I just can't afford to get out to Toronto and pay for the hotel and all that. You're not going either, are you?
No. Honestly, I didn't go to any of the games when they were in Calgary, so...
I wanted to. It was tough to get tickets.
Yeah.
But I really wish, though... In hindsight, I wish that I would have splurged and gone. It would have been fun.
Yeah.
We're looking at... Flames players, they're starting to get selected or not selected for their teams. We're having most of the rosters come out. I don't know if the roster's finalized yet. I think there's still a training camp for most of the teams to go through, right?
Yeah, there's usually like three or four cuts for most teams that trying to get the full roster done.
But so far we've had Flames goaltender... one Flames goaltender and one Flames forward selected. We have Mason McDonald, who's been selected to Canada, and Brandon Hickey selected to Canada. I'm not surprised about McDonald. I think he's one of the better CHL goalies this year. I'm a little bit surprised about Brandon Hickey. What about you?
Well, it's not definitive that he'll make the team.
Right.
He's still a bit of a long shot.
Yeah, no, they've just been invited to the camp, right?
Yeah. honestly, I would expect McDonald to make the team just because he's the de facto starting goaltender for Canada. Hickey, I would be somewhat shocked if he made the team.
Yeah, I think the other thing with Mason McDonald, from a sort of political angle, if you will, is he's playing in the QMJHL. This is co-hosted Montreal. QMJHL is a big part of that. Brandon Hickey's playing in U.S. college, so I think that politically they probably want to get as many guys they can, you know, who are playing CHL to show off that talent.
True, but one of the players that was kind of one of the favorites was Wallman, who plays on Jankowski's team. So
yeah.
But he's hurt.
No, I don't think they'll necessarily go all CHL, but I think if you're debating between two players who are even, let's say on the, you know, in
true.
The depth chart,
yeah, I agree
you'll
with
probably
you.
Take a CHL guy over a guy playing U.S. college hockey.
I agree.
You're not going to not ice the most competitive team just to play a CHL guy, but if there's a tie, you'll pick the Canadian player. Also, we have Adam Olis Mattsson, who's been named as one of the potential guys going to the Swedish team. Not a surprise there.
Yeah, anytime you have a 6'4" defenseman that can play, you need him on the penalty kill and defensively to keep the opposing forwards out of the crease.
Yeah, and he's...
So I can see him making the team because of that.
Yeah, me too. He's a big guy, but he can actually play. He's a large defensive-minded defenseman. His game's pretty simple, but he's a smart player, and I think especially at the World Juniors, that's one of the things you need, a guy who is mobile and who can adjust very quickly to other players.
Mm-hmm.
Are you surprised that neither Shillington nor Anderson were invited to the Swedish team?
Not particularly. There are a lot of quality Swedish defensemen, so the fact that our two guys didn't get selected, it's a disappointment, but it's not a surprise.
And also on the Flames front, Pavel Kharnikov has not been named as one of the potential players going to Russia. It doesn't surprise me as much there. Again, I think there's a lot of good Russian forwards, and I think Kharnikov is... the whole Hitmen team hasn't had a stellar year, but I think Kharnikov especially maybe hasn't been playing up to his potential.
Mm-hmm. So, and it at least allows him to have the flexibility moving forward to play on Belarus if he decides to go that route.
That's true. He's sort of interesting. He's, what, got dual Russian-Belarusian citizenship?
Exactly.
He was born in Belarus, but he played most of his hockey in Russia. So... Interesting. I wonder if you would, I guess it depends how much you want to play, but you wonder how many, if you've got a hockey market like Russia, if you would declare on Belarus just to get more international time. It'd be an interesting thing to debate, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Well, plus if he eventually goes to the KHL, which country declares for might be important as well, because if he declares as a Russian, then he can obviously play without being an international player.
Right.
Where if he declares as he's from Belarus, then because they've cracked down over there, so
right,
we'll see.
I mean, for some guys it's easy. A guy like Robin Regier, a Canadian Brazilian citizenship, you're not gonna say I'll play for Team Brazil. I don't even know if there is a Team Brazil.
I know. It's like Kopitar. He's stuck with the Slovenian national team, which is basically him and a bunch of beer leaguers.
Who was it? There's some guy who's playing for the French team a couple years ago, too. Was it like?
Yeah, well, there's a couple of NHLers, Bellemare and Antoine Roussel, who are from France. So they actually have a couple of guys now.
Yeah, I think it was, I want to say Cristobal Huet played for the French national team. And
yes.
And he was like, just because of their goalie, they were staying in games that they shouldn't have been in some of the Olympic qualifiers.
Well, yeah, you get a near all-star quality goaltender at the time.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter which team you have in front of them, it's going to be difficult to score on them.
I got the chance to see Kharnikov up close and personal this year for the first time. I was at the Teddy Bear Toss, so I saw him and Kanzig. I have to say, from what I saw of Kanzig in the AHL, he looks much more comfortable in the WHL level. I think it's a good thing that they send him back to Calgary. You watch some of those early AHL games. He didn't look like he really fit in or could keep up with the pace, did he?
No. And having him return, like, the knock on Kanzig for the last few years has been his foot speed. Now his foot speed isn't a problem. The problem is the rest of his game now, and he has to learn how to effectively defend, pass, and do all the other things. So he wasn't playing very effectively at the AHL level. So now that he's back in Calgary, he can more effectively focus on the other aspects of his game that he needs to improve.
Yeah, and it seemed like it was just a better fit for him. Like, when I was watching him, I thought, okay, it makes total sense for him to be here. He fits in well. He didn't seem out of place. Like, he always seemed one step behind in the AHL, and this just seems more natural for him. So hopefully he'll improve the rest of his game. He was looking pretty good in the teddy bear toss game, and hopefully he will, you know, be able to make it in the Flames system. But I don't know. I have a strong feeling that this guy might end up being a career minor leaguer.
That's possible, and even if he is basically Chris Breen 2.0, that's a useful player to have in the AHL team.
Oh, for sure,
and
yeah.
Not everybody's going to make the NHL. It's not an easy league to reach, and
no,
you still need to have players that can play for your AHL team, even if they're not destined, so to speak, to reach that NHL goal.
Mm-hmm. And Karnikov looked pretty good too. It's the first time I've seen Karnikov. I've seen Kanzig play with the Hitmen a few times. The first time I've seen Karnikov live, I liked what I saw with him. He wasn't, you know, the best player on the ice, but he was definitely a guy that I see some potential in. So I'm hoping that that late round pick turns into something good for the Flames as well, as we've seen with a few of them lately.
Yeah, well, even if guys like Karnikov and Mangiapane end up playing just like the Kenny Agostino role in Stockton, that's useful just for developmental purposes for the other forwards. Having competent players to play with helps the development of your better players anyway.
Matt, we've covered most of the Flames news for this week. Anything else you want to talk about?
That's it for me. I know we have the Theo Fleury interview coming up right now, so...
We do. So earlier this week, I had the chance to sit down with my favorite Flame growing up.
And mine.
And yours. I think any guy who was a Flames fan in the 90s, he was the face of the team, right?
Pretty much. There was a few other guys that were really good, like Nieuwendyk, McInnes, Vernon, but they all left pretty early in the 90s. Like 95, they were pretty much all gone.
Yeah. And
Theo was the only guy from the Cup years that actually stayed right through the entire decade.
Well, I think Theo is a lot like Jerome, where, you know, he came in young and we saw him mature and progress. And there was sort of a, you know, he was here through thick and thin for so many years. And I think that the city really got attached to him that way. But ever since we started our Old Flame interview series, we've been asking people, what Old Flames do you want us to rekindle? Which Flames alumni do you want us to talk to and figure out what they're up to now? And Theo's name was number one on the list. Everyone said, try to figure out what Fleury's up to. And he's quite busy. So why don't we listen to the interview that I conducted earlier this week with Theo Fleury? This is Dan Stevenson here for Fireside Chat, and we're pleased to be joined tonight by a Flames alumni who really needs no introduction. He's a Stanley Cup winner, multiple-time NHL All-Star, and an Olympic gold medalist. He's one of the best-known Calgary Flames. Theo Fleury, welcome to Fireside Chat.
Yeah, thanks for having me, guys.
Yeah, no problem. It's a pleasure to have you on, and we always ask our fans every year, if we can talk to some Flames and get their story, who would you want us to talk to? And every year it's overwhelmingly come back as Theo Fleury. You're still one of the most loved players on this that's ever worn a Flames jersey, so our fans are eager to hear from you.
That's awesome.
So, Theo, you joined the Flames really in the 89 season, that year that they had their Stanley Cup win. And still to this day, if we talk to any Flames player who played on that team, they say how that team was unique and special. Sometimes the word magical has even been thrown around. What do you think made that team so unique and special?
Well, I think there was lots of factors, you know. Words that I would use would be talent, would be, you know, the first thing to come to mind. But I really believe it's the quality of people, you know, that we had on the team that, you know, made us special. Not only were, you know, we're great hockey players, but I think we're all, to a man, you know, incredible people who, you know, cared about each other and you know, we really enjoyed being together and you know, I think the two of them together, you know, was sort of a, you know, a lethal combination.
Did you find that same kind of camaraderie with your teammates on a lot of the other Calgary Flames teams you played for, or even some of the NHL teams, or was that really a special chemistry with that 89 team specifically?
Well, I would say, you know, most of the championship teams that I was involved with, you know, there was that commonality. There was, you know, a combination of, you know, talent, ability, hard work, and then, you know, the quality of people. And, you know, I think that that is always a factor you need in any time that you are on a championship team, is that, you know, you need not only the talent and the ability, but you need, you know, the quality of people, you know, from top to bottom in order, you know, to accomplish that.
Do you think that we're starting to see that same kind of quality of people being built up in the current Flames team, both from the management perspective, the coaching, and the guys on the ice again?
Yeah, I think they're definitely moving in the right direction. And, you know, what people don't realize is the NHL is a difficult place to win. And winning is hard in the NHL. So you need to create, you know, a lot of different intangibles in order to create a winning situation. And, you know, obviously the addition of, you know, Burke and Brad Treliving and you know, Bob Hart, you know, so, you know, I think they're moving in the right direction. You know, obviously, you know, the expectations that the team set, you know, sure have been sort of, you know, a stumbling block for the team this year. And, you know, but even with that being said, you know, I think they're still, you know, obviously moving in the right direction.
Speaking of the team this year, being a guy who's been around your share of championship teams, as you said, teams that didn't do as well, what do you think maybe is not going so well for the Flames this year? What do you think maybe is causing the problems, and what do you think they need to do to turn it around?
Well, I think the biggest thing to learn as a young player, so I'm talking about Goudreau, Monahan, Bennett, you know, Hamilton.
All those guys who played less than, what, 4 or 5 years in the NHL?
Yeah. Is the hardest thing to learn is to learn how to play with the puck. You know, when you come from junior hockey and, you know, basically, you know, the entire game, you know, when you're on the ice as a young super in whatever league you come from, you always have the puck. So when you get to the NHL level, everybody can play and everybody's good. And so, you know, the biggest transition, especially for me early on in my career, was learning how to play without the puck, which means I got to learn how to play so that I can get it back on my stick. And once I have it back on my stick, then, you know, I can do the things that I do best, and that's to make plays and score goals. And so, you know, and there's such a strength difference when you make the step from junior to the NHL, is, you know, you have to sort of grow into your body. It takes a few years to gain that strength through training in the off season and just maturing in general. And so, you know, that's what we're seeing from the team this year, is that, you know, their inability to keep the puck out of their own net. And, you know, that's just a learning process you have to go through. And, you know, we're obviously not seeing the same goaltending that we saw last year.
Yeah, for sure. I think that's very well said. And I mean, that's what we get for being in the middle of a rebuild, right? We can kind of expect that time for these guys to learn those skills right now.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we saw Colorado, you know, have that one big year when all their young guys were first in the league, and then it's been a transition, you know. You know, the Oilers haven't been able to grasp onto that concept either. You know, I still see, when I'm watching the Oilers play, I'm still seeing, you know, Taylor Hall make the same mistakes that he's made for 5 years. I'm seeing Jordan Eberle making the same mistakes made for 5 years.
So Theo, the NHL game has changed a lot since you were playing, especially since you were wearing a Flames jersey. As far as looking at the game now and the changes that have been made, for better or for worse, what are some of the changes that you like, and what are some of the things that you'd like to see still changing or evolving in the current game?
I think the game's in a great state, you know. You know, obviously, the game is faster. You know, guys look after themselves better. You know, they eat better, they rest better. You know,
do you think they're treating them more like they're, I guess, athletes now than perhaps in the past?
Well, I wouldn't say that. I just think that you know, we're evolving as a you know, as a human race, and you know, we know more, way more about training and nutrition and all these things, you know, than we did when, you know, obviously we were playing. And so, you know, that's what we're seeing, is the evolution of the athlete in general. And, you know, I love 3-on-3 overtime now. You know, there's a lot of, there's a lot of great things about, you know, where the game is at right now. You know, obviously, we know more about injuries. You know, we're getting guys back quicker, you know, than we did in the past. And so, you know, yeah, there's a lot of great things that you know, how the game's evolving. And
do you still watch a lot of NHL?
Oh yeah, I watch as much as I can. You know, I'm not a fanatical fan, but I'm obviously, you know, I'm always interested in what the Flames are doing. So what would I change? I don't know if I would change. I don't like that they're talking about making the nets bigger.
Yeah, I mean, that kind of changes the era too, right? Then you'd have an era of the smaller nets and the bigger nets. It'd be a weird change.
Yeah, and, you know, that's the evolution of the goalie as well, you know? I would say when I was playing that the goalies weren't necessarily, you know, the best athletes, or they were the most athletic. You know, now they seem to be the best athletes, and that's just, you know, how the game has evolved. And you know, I think making the equipment smaller is probably the answer to creating more offense. But, you know, even by doing that, I think the goalies will adjust to making the equipment smaller. So, you know, it's just where we're at. You know, the game is where we're at. But, you know, I still see teams on different occasions that you know, score 7 or 8 goals in a night. So, you know, I'm not exactly sure what they're talking about when they say they need more offense. But, you know, I think coaching has been a big part of that.
How so?
Well, I think the coaches are playing Xbox with these guys, you know, basically. And, you know, you don't see a whole lot of one-on-one play. You see a lot of dumping and chasing and a lot of play being, you know, played along the boards and the pucks kept out of the middle. You know, when teams back-check, they back-check right to the hash marks, which creates a lot of traffic in front of the net, which creates a lot of opportunities and shots being blocked. And, you know, so I think if they made the width of the rink 30 feet wider, so 15 on each side, and widen the rink by 15 feet, that would solve a lot of the game's problems and issues.
Interesting. So almost an Olympic size of rink.
But not.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, interesting.
The what is it, 200 by 100?
Yeah.
So you're basically making it 200 by 95.
Okay, so close. Yeah.
Yeah, close.
Interesting.
Close. Or even 7 feet on either side. You know, just make it, you know, a little bit bigger.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
So in anticipation for you coming on the show tonight, we'd ask some of our fans if they had any questions for you. And one big question that we heard from a number of our fans on Twitter, number 14 has become part of your brand. Where did the number 14 come from? Why did you select that to be your number?
I didn't select it. They selected it for me. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah. When I my whole minor hockey league career and my whole junior career, I wore the number 9. And so when I got to Calgary, Lanny wasn't willing to give me that number. So they gave me number 14, and that's the number that I basically wore for my whole entire career.
That's weird.
Yeah.
Cool.
And then when I played for Team Canada, Brendan Shanahan, who was a lot of those times was on those teams, you know, he had more seniority than I did. And so, you know, that's why I chose to wear 74, for Team Canada a few times.
Did you ever think about flipping around and being 41 for Team Canada?
No, it's not a cool number, 41.
74 was a cool number. I had a 74 Fleury jersey as a kid.
Ah, there you go. Awesome.
Another question we got from one of our Twitter followers is, can you share with us one of your favorite stories or memories as a Flame? Is there one kind of scenario that really sticks out for you? Maybe something that happened off the ice, maybe, you know, an on-ice scenario. What's the one thing that really sticks out to you as your time as a Flame?
You know, I was drafted in 1987 in the 8th round. And so, you know, I basically look at that as, there was actually 20 rounds of the draft that went by before I got drafted. So, you know, the year I was actually eligible, the first year, I didn't get drafted. And then, you know, another 8 rounds after that. So, you know, I think that my whole entire life, you know, people told me that I was never going to, you know, play one game in the National Hockey League. And, you know, the Flames in 1987 gave me, you know, that hope and that dream that, you know, I could actually maybe one day play in the NHL. And so I would say my whole entire career as a Calgary Flame, you know, them giving me a chance and them giving me an opportunity and then, you know, to be brought up on New Year's Day of 1989 and 6 months later, you know, carrying the Stanley Cup around the Montreal Forum and then going on to, you know, hold all these records with the Flames and all that. So I would say, you know, there's lots of incredible highlights that I had as a Calgary Flame, but, you know, I think most importantly was that, that I got to live out my dream and I did most of it, wearing the Flaming C on my chest, you know, from the Stanley Cup in 89 to scoring the goal in Edmonton, that iconic goal where I'm sliding across the ice to, you know, breaking Al MacInnis's record and then coming back in 09 and making the comeback and, you know, having the opportunity to score that shootout goal. You know, there were so many incredible moments, as a Calgary Flame. I can't really say one was better or greater than the other. I just think my whole time and my whole experience and, you know, learning from guys like Lanny and Pep and Timmy Hunter and, you know, all those incredible hockey players that I got to play with, Joe Newendike, Gary Roberts, you know, Sergei Makarov, you know, it was really a cool place. And that's, you know, why when I retired from the game and I'd moved away from Calgary, it was probably the biggest reason why I moved back to Calgary was that, you know, Calgary is a special place for me and my family, and you know, it is home, and you know, now to be retired and doing lots of amazing things, not only in Calgary, but, you know, right across North America, it's been pretty cool.
You mentioned your return in 09 and the shootout goal, and I don't know if you knew this or not, but the player you scored on, the goaltender who was with the Islanders at the time, was Kevin Poulin, who, interestingly enough, just got acquired by the Flames about 2 weeks ago and is now playing for our AHL affiliate.
Yeah, I saw that, and I don't know if you saw the tweet that I tweeted out, but it was funny that, you know, sometimes your career comes full circle, you know, and you know, that was a special night at the Saddle Dome, not only for myself, but, you know, for everybody that was there and witnessed that.
I had the privilege of being there, and it was an amazing night.
It was an amazing night, and, you know, obviously I didn't get to leave the game on my terms, and, you know, when that puck went across the goal line in the shootout, you know, it was my life sort of coming full circle, and was so incredibly special, not only for myself, but, you know, after the game, coming home and seeing all the social media stuff and people, you know, had recorded on their cell phones and, you know, grown men crying in the stands, you know, it was a special evening, and it was really kind of cool to be part of that.
I remember just sitting in the stands that game and just looking around and seeing guys, just random strangers, hugging each other after that goal. Like, everybody was just so happy for Theo Fleury.
Yeah, well, it was really cool. Very, very cool.
I don't know if they did or not, but if the Flames would have offered you a two-way contract with the expectation of going to the AHL that year, would you have signed it?
Sure. Absolutely. Yeah.
That was something we talked about on our show at the time, is that Theo would have been a great mentor in the AHL.
Yeah, but, you know, at 41 years old, you know, obviously I think it would have been, it's probably more important that they develop, you know, a player down there and not have me take ice time away from somebody and whatnot. So I'm sure that it was well thought out and you know, shortly after the comeback, my book came out and you know, I haven't really stopped since then. And you know, I've really found some incredible purpose, for my life. And that's, you know, helping other people who've had similar experiences, such as myself. And it's been incredibly rewarding. And you know, it's really, you know, the purpose for me going through all that stuff, you know, in my childhood and in my adolescence, that, you know, that I absolutely cherish the most, and it's what I love to do.
Yeah. I mean, you've said that your mission statement right now is to help as many people get to where they want to go. And I think, you know, with the work that you've done, you're definitely on that road.
Yeah, there's no question about it. You know, I think nobody on the face of the earth is immune from trauma, and you know, my experience has been that a lot of people, not only in Canada but worldwide, you know, share a lot of my childhood experience and, you know, have those things that happen to them in life, and so yeah, it's been kind of very, very cathartic to, you know, do the work that I do now and, you know, inspire other people and so it's been very cool, and like I said, you know, you never know where your life's gonna turn out or where it's gonna end up and where you're gonna be. But you know, I'm very happy that I was sort of pushed into this, you know, this new role after hockey.
And speaking of where life takes you, you've had quite an interesting career since you left hockey. You ran a concrete business, filmed a pilot for a reality show. You tried to market your own clothing line. You played pro baseball. You were on Battle of the Blades. You've published two books, and now you have a country album out.
Yeah.
Do you ever sleep, Theo?
Yeah, I do. I do. And
you're a busy man.
Like I said, it's been really cool. And I think really the message is that, you know, no matter where we are in life, how old we are, or, you know, just go for it. you know, surround yourself with good people who are like-minded and work hard and are dedicated. You know, there's really nothing that you can accomplish in this world. And, you know, we're incredibly excited about the album and you know, we're really proud of what we've sort of come up with. And, you know, we're looking forward to getting out on tour in March. On March the 3rd, we'll be at the Grey Eagle Casino in Calgary putting on a show. So, you know, everybody who's out there listening, make sure you get down to the Grey Eagle on March the 3rd and, you know, we'll put on a show for you.
Tickets are available online. They start at $45. And if you're interested, there's a really cool VIP package that you can get. Some levels include a meet and greet with Theo. It should be a fun night.
Yeah, it'll be really cool. And we're starting the tour off in Saskatoon and Regina and Medicine Hat. Those are three places that have a lot of history when I played for the Moose Jaw Warriors. So we're looking forward to, you know, to those stops as well.
So Theo, being Métis, I mean, music is part of the culture in many Native cultures, especially with the Métis. Growing up, did you play an instrument? Did you sing? Where did this, you know, musical side come from?
Well, my fondest memories as a child growing up in Manitoba were sitting beside my grandfather listening to him play the fiddle, and my dad was an entertainer, my uncle was an entertainer, and you know, I actually have a cousin that lives in Calgary who has her own band that plays a lot of the clubs here in Calgary. But she finished in the top 10 of Canadian Idol, I believe, in 2005. So, you know, it is definitely a part of our DNA. And, you know, I remember those family gatherings when I was a kid that were, you know, somebody always had a guitar and a fiddle, and, you know, there was a lot of singing and dancing and, you know, a lot of laughs. And so, yeah, and I always sang, you know, I always had a karaoke machine in whatever house I lived in, whether that was in Calgary or New York or Chicago. You know, there was always an opportunity for me to sing. And, you know, when I retired, I had a friend in the music industry, based out of Winnipeg, and, you know, our dads used to play music together before we were even born. So, you know, it was kind of a serendipitous type of thing. And so I went to Winnipeg and started writing, you know, songs. And it was pretty amazing experience.
I bet. And I had the pleasure of listening to the album. There's 10 songs in the album. When I listened to the album, I thought it was quite refreshing. I mean, there's so much country today. It sort of has a poppy feel to it, sort of this mainstream country. Yours is very much a throwback type album. It's very much your kind of classic country. Who were some of your musical inspirations when you were writing and putting this album together?
Well, you know, when I was, you know, sitting beside my grandfather, listening to my dad sing, you know, there was a lot of Buck Owens and Johnny Cash and, you know, Conway Twitty, all these old guys that sort of, you know, and I would say even George Strait, Alan Jackson, you know, these kind of guys that, you know, that were a major sort of influence. And you know, when we sat down to sort of figure out what kind of music we wanted to put out there, we didn't want to be country pop or country rock, or, you know, we wanted to bring back the, you know, the steel guitar and the fiddle and the banjos and the honky-tonk piano. So there's a lot of that influence, you know, in the album.
Yeah, you can definitely hear it. It's quite cool.
Yeah, thank you.
When you were on the road, when you were, you know, playing hockey professionally, was country music sort of your favorite genre? Is that what you listened to on the road and in the dressing room and that sort of thing?
Well, I didn't get to listen to it in the dressing room, because every time I put it on, the guys would turn it off. So, but you know, I always had a Walkman first, right?
Oh wow, yeah, that's dating yourself, Theo.
With cassette tapes, and then I had a Discman with all that, and then eventually, you know, had the old sort of MP3 player, and you know, they always had a lot of Johnny Cash, a lot of Buck Owens, and I still have those guys on my iPhone and on my iTunes, and so
that's pretty cool.
You know, I love the old country stuff, and so yeah, the album is sort of a thank you to my grandfather and my dad, for sort of giving me this musical talent that I didn't really know that I had.
Do you plan to have a second album?
Yes, absolutely, for sure. I have so many notes on my iPhone of, future songs and future ideas. So whenever there's something that pops in my head, I always make sure that I put it in my notepad on my phone. So
I can't wait to hear the second one. The band, Theo Fleury and the Death Valley Rebels.
Yes.
Where did the name Death Valley Rebels come from?
Well, back in the 80s when the Oilers and the Flames had those amazing hockey teams, they called that stretch of highway between here and Edmonton, they called it Death Valley, because when teams came in the 80s, they usually left with 0 points and a lot of minuses on their scorecard. And so they used to call that stretch of highway Death Valley. And we thought, that's a pretty cool name to call the band.
That's cool. I know there's a lot of people that, have never heard the album yet. It only got released in October, but definitely go grab a copy. It's only on iTunes right now, correct?
And you can get it at HMV and Walmart. So
nice. So grab a copy. If anyone still buys CDs, you can use them like Theo did in his Discman.
Yes.
You can play it on your iPhone, whatever works for you, but it's worth a listen. It's definitely a cool album.
Well, and it's very consistent with the message that we sort of carry with us, on a daily basis, and that's hope and healing. And, it's a dark album, and,
it is for sure. Yeah.
Cause obviously I need to get some things off my chest musically, and, it is a country album. So, most country albums, true country albums, talk about, life struggles and how to figure out how to get out of them.
Yeah, for sure. It definitely has that, a good country song to me has always told a story, and all of the songs on this album do a really good job of telling that story in the classic sort of country music style.
Yeah. And, I'll say this, I'm not the greatest singer in the world, but what I can do as good as anybody is I can tell a good story. And, Johnny Cash wasn't the greatest singer in the world, but what he did better than anybody else was he told a hell of a story. And so, that's sort of, why the album is sort of the way that it is, and the one thing I discovered after writing Playing with Fire was that, you take all of the hockey out of my book and I'm telling 1/3 of the population of the world stories of people who have experienced, childhood trauma and how we end up sort of coping with, the emotional pain and scars that are left behind from these experiences in our childhood. And eventually, some way, somehow, we hit the old proverbial rock bottom, and then we start to climb back out of the sort of the abyss of that emotional pain. And really, that's what the album sort of, the story of the album is.
Yeah, we had a lot of people when we asked them to share their memories of you in anticipation of this interview. A lot of guys who said what an inspiration you've been. A guy who hit rock bottom, who had that trauma, and who's come back and really, acted as a crusader against a lot of this and showing people it can be done. So, Theo, even outside of hockey, you've changed lives of fans everywhere.
Well, and that's been my experience. I remember, the first book signing we did in Toronto, and I didn't really have a whole lot of expectations for the book other than, for my own selfish reasons, which was, to put this stuff down on paper, take one last look at it and put it in its rightful place, which was, the past. And so I show up at this book signing, 400 people show up at this book signing, and I was like, this is weird, And so I started signing books, and out of the corner of my eye, I spot this guy in line, and he's got my book clutched against his chest, and his face is buried in the floor, and he's walking really slow. And, I followed him all the way to the front of the line. He gets to the front of the line. He sets the book on the table and, you know, looks me in the eye and says, me too. And you know, that's when I sort of knew the reason why I wrote this book. And since that first me too, you know, we've had over, you know, 500,000 other people, either directly or indirectly say me too as well. So, you know, it's the reason why I do what I do. And it's to help other people find their own voice. And when you find your own voice, you know, there's so much empowerment that happens, you know, when we get an opportunity to tell our story in a safe place, in a safe environment. And you know, that's really what it's all about. And I think that's the reason why we're all here, is to help people who've had difficult things happen in their life. It's you know, sort of our job that we are there for somebody to help them get through, you know, the most difficult times in their life. Because, you know, there's been so many people that have helped me along the way. It's sort of me, a way of me, you know, paying back them for you know, being there for me when I needed people the most.
And I mean, we've all had people that have been there for us, and I totally agree with you. I mean, as a species, as a race, we have to help out other people. That's just how this world's going to keep being a good place.
Yeah, absolutely. But I think, you know, trauma is the string which binds us all together, and you know, nobody's immune to trauma, and that's been my experience, because I've ran into so many people, you know, literally millions, who've expressed to me that they've also had that same experience.
And Theo, if someone is experiencing trauma, whether it's, you know, the similar trauma you experienced in their childhood, whatever it is, what advice can you give those people to, you know, help them cope, help them get through that?
Well, you know, they're certainly not alone in their experience, but, their experience is, like I said, the most common experience in our life. And that, you know, you just need to find a safe place or a safe person to be able to, you know, tell your truth. And like I said, once you're able to express that and say it, there's an incredible amount of empowerment that comes behind it.
For sure. Very powerful words, Theo.
Thank you.
Anything else you want to share with the Flames fans listening tonight? Anything, any upcoming appearances, anything else? We got the tour, we got the album. Anything else you're up to that you want to share?
I've always been grateful for, you know, the support of, you know, the Calgary Flames fans, every step of the way. And, you know, when I moved back here a few years ago, you know, the city opened its arms for me once again, and have been absolutely incredible supporters for all the things that I'm doing, and so it's much appreciated, and glad that they've been there for me when I needed them the most.
For sure. And it's, you know, I mean, I was a kid growing up in the 90s. You were the face of the Flames for me growing up. So I know how much you meant to me, even inspiring me as a hockey player. And we've heard that from so many people of all ages that, you know, whether it's your hockey, what you've done after, how big of an inspiration you've been. So I think this city's as fortunate to have you as it sounds like you are to have this city.
Well, you know, the feeling is definitely mutual, and you know, there's still lots of great stuff that we're going to experience, together down the road, and I look forward to that.
And I hope that I'll see everyone listening tonight at the Grey Eagle Casino on March 3rd when Theo Fleury and the Death Valley Rebels stop here on their tour. That's an 8 o'clock show. Tickets start at $45, or you can get into the VIP meet and greet. You looking forward to the tour, Theo?
Yeah, absolutely. Can't wait. Can't wait. I know I can't wait. Can't wait to get out there and start performing. And, you know, it'll be a concert unlike any that you've ever been to, because you know, it'll be very sort of interactive and you know, a lot of great storytelling.
Sounds like fun.
All right.
Thanks so much, Theo. We appreciate your time tonight.
Okay, guys.
Have a good one.
No problem.
That was our chat with Theo Fleury here on Fireside Chat. Well, Matt, there you go. That was my interview with Theo Fleury, and we heard about his album and his tour. If you haven't checked it out, everybody, make sure you check out Theo's album. It's an interesting listen. Matt, with that, it's time for our prediction game. You ready to go?
Yeah.
Last week, we had 4 points on the table. We had two potential games. We had had Dallas and Boston, and you did better than I did better than you did. I thought that we would lose to Dallas and beat Boston for 2 points, and you thought the Flames would get skunked on the week. So I'm so glad you weren't right.
Yeah. Well, I was hoping that the reverse psychology game that has been successful at times this season might work. So that's why I went with the donut. So I'm glad it worked.
So now the question is, do you keep going with that strategy all year, or are you going to change
your strategy?
Yeah,
I think I'm going to tank it the rest of the year.
Yeah. Let's hope,
or at least until we get back into things.
Well, let's hope then that you're not right until then.
Yeah.
Because if we get another week with a donut, I think the Flames have lost that little bit of grip that they have.
True.
All right, my friends. So this week we've got 3 games, all at the Saddle Dome. First one's tomorrow night on Tuesday the 8th when the San Jose Sharks come to town. We have Thursday a 7 p.m. start against the Buffalo Sabres, and Saturday's a later game. It's an 8 p.m. start against the New York Rangers. 2 Eastern Conference games, 1 Western Conference against one of our direct rivals there. Interesting week. Do you want to make your prediction first?
2 points.
2 points. Which two?
Buffalo.
You think that's the only game we're going to get?
Yeah. With how they struggled mightily against San Jose in the Shark Tank, I don't know if they can successfully rebound enough to actually get the win. And the Flames really have problems with the New York Rangers for whatever reason. So I think we'll end up dropping both of those.
Okay, so you're not going completely with the donut.
No.
I'm going to go for 4 points this week, 4 of the 6. I think that the Flames are going to ride the momentum. If it was any other result last week, I wouldn't pick the Sharks as a win. But I think the Flames are going to be able to ride their momentum and at least take it to overtime against the Sharks, in which case, if they take it to overtime, we've seen this year that they're generally successful. I also think that they're going to beat Buffalo. I was going to do the sweep, but yeah, I'm not sure about the Rangers, like you said. I mean, we beat Dallas, who's a better team, but I think after 2 more wins, the Flames haven't shown us they can sustain it for 5 wins in a row.
Well, they haven't even really been able to show that they've been able to sustain a two-game winning streak.
So, yeah, well, what if we look at it as 2 separate home win streaks?
Yeah.
One last week and then a different win streak. I don't know. We got to find something. But
yeah,
I don't know. I think they're going to ride the wave against the Sharks. I just think that everything's firing the way it should be. And then I think Buffalo, if we can't beat Buffalo with the way they played last week, there's some huge issues going on.
Yeah. Well, then it's just a continuation of the first 2 months. And the Flames will remain in 30th. And yeah. Fun times.
Yeah, I think that's really a make or break game to say, look, we got our crap together. You know, we can easily walk over Buffalo.
Yeah. Well, realistically, this week is the make or break week of the season. Like, we're 30th in the league and we have only a 5-point deficit from a playoff spot, 6 for home ice. If we can't build on the success from last week and turn that corner and start putting together a lengthy winning streak, then you might as well just pack it in and we're done.
Well, if you look at this month, we have 11 games left until the calendar turns to 2016. 7 of those 11 are at home. And we've seen the Flames are generally playing better at home. When we're having, you know, our 2-game win streaks, they've been at home so far. We're generally playing better hockey in the Dome. So hopefully the home cooking advantage is going to help out, and I would like to see us go better than 500 in every week of our home stretch.
Yeah, and to get back into it, for the month that playing 13 games, they need 9 or 10 wins. We already have 2 in the books, so with the remaining 11 games, the Flames need to win 7 or 8 of them, which it's going to be a tall order. Because we do play a lot of good teams.
Every home game.
Yeah, we play a lot of good teams. And they dug themselves a hole. If they want to get back into it and be a realistic playoff team, they have to just win, period. Doesn't matter who they're playing, where, which rink they're in, they have to win. And if they had a better first 2 months, then, you know, if you go on the road trip next week and you only win one game, okay, that's fine. But they're behind the eight ball. They need at least two or three, even though they're playing teams that are all pretty much in the top 10.
The Flames made this mess, and now they have to clean it up.
Yeah, and the only way to do that is to beat the snot out of the opposition.
Well, Matt, I think that's probably all we've got to talk about this week, but happy 100th to you, and that's the 100th episode in the books.
Yeah, and here's to another 100 coming up.
For sure. Everyone stay tuned. We'll be back before you know it for episode 200.
Yep. Sometime in 2018.
There you go.
Yep.
I'm gonna mark it on my calendar this time in 2018.
Yep.
Have a good week, my friend.
Yep. Take it easy, and thanks for listening to all our ramblings over the last 100 episodes.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.